Hey Alexa, does God still heal?
I don't know that one. I can't do explanations yet.
Entitled Big Questions, where we've been taking a look at the questions that you've identified from the surveys back in December that you wanted to know the answers to from the pages of Scripture. And if you were with us a few weeks ago, you know that Pastor Justin kicked us off 2 weeks ago with a message that dealt with the question, when does discernment end and judgment begin? And last week, we took a little break from this series as Beth Greco and our national partner, the Hoving Home, were here to let us know all the great things that God is doing in and through the Hoving Home, helping women transform their lives from addiction. And we have a role to play in that. Our generosity helps in that effort, and we were excited for them to be here. But today, we're going to pick this big question series back up again with another top big question. And that question is this: how do I stop procrastinating? How do I stop procrastinating? How many people would say they are pros at procrastinating? I think a lot of us, it made it into the top big questions. Yeah, two hands. All right. I can remember a time when I was in college. I went to Cornell University in Ithaca, New York. If anyone knows about Ithaca or upstate New York, you know that upstate New York has a few colleges, a couple of hospitals, a lot of cows, and after that, a whole lot of nothing. When I was getting in my car one time to drive from Ithaca to our family home in Poughkeepsie, New York, about 3.5 hours away, and I knew when I started the journey that I probably needed to stop for gas. Probably didn't have enough gas to make it. But when I got behind the wheel and started, what happened to me has probably happened to a lot of you. I started zoning. I was in grad school. I was in the middle of my master's thesis, this 100-page monster of a book, and my brain just started going there. And I just blew past every gas station. I was zoning. Like I said, it's probably happened to a lot of you. What probably has not happened to a lot of you is that I didn't stop zoning until I used every last drop of gasoline in the tank, just enough fumes to get me off to the side of the road. I had to get out of the car, and I had to start walking. And did I mention to you that there's a whole lot of nothing in upstate New York? I was walking for a while. I can look back on that story now and laugh. In fact, that's what we tend to do with this topic of procrastination. A lot of humor, a lot of jokes I've found just in preparation for today up on the internet. Like, here's a couple. I'm taking care of my procrastination issues. Just you wait and see. Or how about this one? I'm not a procrastinator. I just prefer doing all my work in a deadline-induced panic. How many people can relate to that? Yep. Or finally, this one. Top 10 reasons I procrastinate. Number one, yeah, I'm on to something else, you know. I don't have time for it. And what would a discussion in the 21st century with what exists online, what would a discussion about procrastination be without one of these? I'm sorry, if you've got a lot of thoughts in your mind or some emotions that you're dealing with, that's good stuff. I mean, you know, just put a page holder in your day. You can find a cute pet video or a cute baby video, you know. That's good stuff. But I think we tend to put, and I saw a couple of you, didn't change expression. I just want you to know, we're going to have some prayer up here later. And we'll just lay hands on you, get the demons out of you. I mean, that'll just uplift you, right? But we tend to do this. We tend to laugh about procrastination. We tend to use humor. We tend to use language that kind of masks this topic. And I think God has got a lot to say about it. And it's a serious topic, obviously, to all of you because it made it into the top big questions. But I tend to think it's also serious and important that we should carve out some time and talk about it, because what we tend to procrastinate about tends to be important took a look at some surveys, aggregated what I could see as the kind of top five things that we tend to procrastinate about. We tend to procrastinate about getting a health concern checked, or check-in call with family or friends, paying monthly bills, searching for a new job, whether we have a job we're not satisfied with or we're out of work, and eating better. These are important topics. They speak to our finances, our relationship, our health. And I think what we tend to do is we tend to, one way or another, adopt a someday mentality. Someday I'm going to get to these things that I procrastinate about. Someday things will be more palatable to deal with them. And that's kind of what the definition of procrastinate is to put off until later or someday. So I want to just kind of give you the big idea. I want to give you the kind of big takeaway from this topic of procrastination. And it's this. Many of us believe the lie that it will be easier to deal with things someday, when the truth about the matter is that doing the right thing only becomes more difficult when we put off doing it. When we kick that can down the road, when we go around that mountain one more time, things just become a lot more difficult dealing with that thing that we know we should be doing, that good thing that we've been putting off. It's like I said, it's a someday mentality. Someday things will be easier. Like someday I'm going to start dating my wife again. See, now, Pastor Andy, now you're messing with us. I was okay with the pet videos, but someday I'm going to begin dating my wife again. You know, when things calm down in the house, when the schedule starts to get a little bit lighter, you know, we're taking this kid to that activity and that kid to that sport. You don't know my calendar, Andy. You know, or maybe when the kids are grown, then I'll start dating my wife again, when God's got a lot to say. Men, husbands, about loving your wives, loving them sacrificially, and not putting off until someday what God's calling us to do today. Someday, I'm going to start dating my wife again. Or how about this? Someday, I'm going to become more generous. You know, when things start to improve in our financial situation, when I get that big promotion, then I'll have more money to become more generous with. When God's got a lot to say about those who are faithful with little, much will be given. That's why Jesus points to the woman with two mites, not because she gave a lot, but because she gave generously. And he called her out as the most generous, right? Someday, I'm going to become more generous. Or how about this one? Someday, I'm going to start pursuing that interest, that foreign language I've been thinking about learning, or that instrument that I wanted to start learning how to play, or that activity, that computer time to sit down and put those ideas together in a book. Someday, I'm going to pursue that interest when I have the time to do it, when God's got a lot to say about the concept of sowing and reaping, and we get out what we put in with not a someday mentality, but a today mentality. Or how about this one? Someday, I'm going to let someone into my pain. You know, when there's enough time between me and that pain, then I'll think about maybe someday letting someone in. When James, the half-brother of Jesus, has a lot to say about confessing one to another so that the healing process can begin. We want the healing process to begin today, not someday. We adopt a someday mentality, and what I'd like us all to see is that procrastination has the ability to turn a problem into a crisis when we keep putting off the good things that we know we should be doing until later or until someday. It has an ability to turn what is a problem into a crisis. I want us to realize today that we tend to pay a larger price collectively than we're willing to admit because of procrastination. Behind the laughs and the humor, behind the jokes and the language that we sometimes use as a rationalization or a justification for procrastination, that we think and spend a lot of time focused on a someday mentality. Someday is not an actual day of the week. I know it might sound like it. Saturday, Sunday, someday. It's not. In fact, today is yesterday's someday. God wants us to adopt a two-day mentality. And he does that in many places throughout the Bible, but I want to focus our attention here in the book of James, chapter 4, verses 13 through 17. It says this. James says, "Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow, we will go into such and such a town, and we will spend a year there, and we will trade, and we will make a profit, yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. And then James asks a very important, very introspective question. What is your life? What is your life? I'd encourage all of us to ask this question daily, especially if we have a procrastination issue, especially if we have a Sunday mentality. What is your life? This is not some big esoteric question. James does answer it for us in the next verse. Are you ready for the answer? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Don't you feel blessed this morning? Have a great Sunday. Goodbye, everybody. You know? James lets us know, it's sobering, but it's true. We are here for a short period of time. If we spend so much time and so much focus on the plans of the future, on the things that we'll do someday, when God wants us to see the true gift that he's given to us right here and right now, this is a wake-up call, for you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Goes on to say, instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and we will do this or we will do that. As it is, you boast in your arrogance, and all such boasting is evil. So whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him or for her, it is sin. This is a big statement, and this tends to take the topic of procrastination from the humorous to the serious. We often think of sin as the wrong things that we shouldn't do, and occasionally we do. We ask for forgiveness, the sin of commission. James raises the standard. He raises the bar to not only include the wrong things that we know we shouldn't do, but actually include the right things that we've been putting off doing, the sin of omission. We often mask the sin of omission, like I said earlier, with language that kind of insulates ourselves and bubble wraps ourselves from the reality of having a two-day mentality. We use phrases like, well, I had good intentions. You know, you know my heart. How easy is it for us to judge other people by their actions, judge other people by their words, judge other people by the evidence that they show us? But for us, well, I had good intentions. You know me. I'm going to get around to it, you know, someday. So I want to take this topic and I want to spend our time this morning helping us get practical with it. I want to answer the question, how do we convert good intentions into wise actions? If we've got a procrastination issue, if we've got a someday mentality, if we've been relying on our good intentions to do the things that God is telling us to do, knowing that if we put them off, if we kick the can down the road, it's just going to be harder, more difficult for us to actually do them, start them, fix them, finish them, whatever it is that God is telling you to do. I want to help us with a strategy on how do we convert good intentions into wise actions. The first thing we need to do is we need to seize the day. We need to actually seize this day, today. It's carpe diem, man. You know, we've heard that phrase before. That phrase actually comes from a Roman poet named Horace a few years before the birth of Christ and a few more years before James wrote those words that we just took a look at. In Horace's most famous work, Odes, written in 23 BC, he wrote this phrase. It's a Latin phrase. It's carpe diem quam minimum credula postero. 4 years of high school Latin finally comes in handy, man. Awesome. Latin for the win. It means, literally, pluck the day, trusting as little as possible in the next one. Can you just kind of see the influence of Horace's words in the verses we looked at in James? Pluck the day. Pluck it like you would a flower from the ground or a piece of fruit from the tree. It kind of makes sense, right? God gives us visual evidence all around us. The gift that he's actually presented, the gift of today. Sometimes, oftentimes, we fall into procrastination issues because we are focused so much, James tells us, on the things we're going to do, on the plans we're going to make, on the good intentions that are going to be awesome later, someday. And God gives us a visual reminder every day to pluck the day, to seize the day, take advantage of what God has presented to us. That's why I often start my prayers, thank you, Lord, for the gift of today, right now. What are you doing? What are you saying? How can I be a part of it? This idea of the gift of today is replete throughout the Bible. Here's an example found in Hebrews chapter 3, verse 13. But encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. This idea that James says is arrogant, and we boast because we sometimes bypass what God has right in front of us for the plans that we're all going to make later, someday. Encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today. Last week, Beth Greco, as I said earlier, was here representing the Hoving Home, our national partner, and she asked, I think, a very important question, a very thought-provoking question, when she said, do we live today ready to leave? That's one of the question perspectives that they present to the women who are battling addiction and come into the Hoving Home. If God said to you, your life would be over in 5 minutes, as a follower of Christ, as a citizen of heaven, would you be happy about it? Get to spend eternity with Christ? Or would you be sad because of all those plans that you have in the future, all those big, bold milestones on the timeline of your life that you may or may not have achieved yet, the child you want to have, the marriage you want to have, the home you want to buy, all those things that a lot of times, oftentimes, we spend so much time focused on instead of the gift of today? Are we living today with eternity in mind? Are we taking advantage truly of the gift that he's presented to us right here, right now? You know, one of the lies that we tend to believe and the language that we tend to wrap this issue of procrastination around is that I'm only good under pressure. You know, I've said that. It's born out of our school days, right? When the deadline's approaching, when we put off doing the paper, studying for the test, and now here's the deadline. And it's approaching. And somehow, some way, we pulled an all-nighter, we crammed, and we got a decent grade, and then we just adopted that as my identity, my mentality. I've got a someday mentality. The deadline's coming up someday, and heck, I'm good under pressure, so no worries. That's why the psalmist tells us in chapter 90, verse 12, teach us to number our days. Teach us to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom, a heart of wisdom that takes advantage of the true gift that God's given to us right here, right now. I love what the psalmist says. That's why I highlighted, teach us. This is not something that innately comes to us. This is not something organic in us. We have to learn this. We have to be taught this. Heck, what does a 5-year-old want more than anything besides a chocolate chip cookie or something like that? That child wants to become 6. More than anything, wants to grow. And when we're 10, we want to be 12. When we're 15, we want to be 18, because 18, you get to do some stuff. You know, we're constantly forward-looking. We're constantly goal-oriented. We're constantly in a someday mentality. Teach us to number our days so that we may gain a heart of wisdom, a wise perspective that allows us to see more fully what God is doing in and around us. Billy Graham was asked, what was the biggest surprise of your life? And his answer kind of surprised me. He said, how fast it went. This is a man who lived chronologically to the age of 99, but in what he accomplished, lived many lifetimes. And his biggest surprise of his 99 years on earth was how fast it went. A few weeks ago, I just turned 50. I had to work myself to get that out. Suzanne and I now are the parents of 2 teenagers. When the kids are little and you're changing the diapers and you're just trying to get to nap time, it can seem like the days are going long, but boy, the years go quick. Billy Graham is right and wise. And that's why James gives us that introspective, sobering, but serious, thought-provoking question. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. It's like the fog that occurs here in Delaware. You know, being from New York, we had storms and nor'easters. It produced snow and it produced ice. Here, we come here and the kids have two-hour delays because of fog. This is a new phenomenon for us transplants, but that's what it is. You can't see in front of you. But then noontime comes and the sun burns off the fog, and all of a sudden, You can see it's kind of like that. You're here for a short time, like the mist, and then you're gone. Matthew 6:34, if those of you who know that verse in the Gospel of Matthew, it says, "Do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself." I want to give you Eugene Peterson's The Message version of 6:34. It says, "Give your entire attention to what God is doing right now." Boy, boom. That's an awesome statement. And don't get worked up about what may or may not happen tomorrow. God will help you deal with whatever hard things come up when the time comes. We've got a saying in the Salino house, it's not a problem until it's a problem. And it doesn't mean stick your head in the sand. It doesn't mean don't anticipate, don't prepare. But it means, boy, we can allow little things to become big things and big things to become monumental things and spend so much time on the what-ifs and the scenario building and the filling in the blanks and the script writing that sometimes we can lose our focus on what's happening right here and right now. Give your entire attention to what God is doing right now. So I think if we are to seize the day, I think if we are to walk out a two-day mentality and a carpe diem mindset, I think we got to get practical and we got to get specific. I think we need to be reminded about this topic that we tend to joke about, we tend to build language around to insulate us and to almost rationalize and justify putting off the right thing that we know God is wanting us to do. I think we need to get specific because I really don't think we can do anything meaningful about procrastination until we're honest and specific about it. So I put the question to all of you, what is the good thing that you know you ought to do and thus far you have failed to do? What is it? I think you got to name it if you hope to change it. And so for some of you, it may be spiritual. Maybe you've been doing the dues of faith, but you haven't really fully embraced God. Maybe it's been more of an outward appearance of faith instead of an inward transformation of faith. Maybe for some of us, we need to more fully embrace our relationship with God, giving up areas of our life, really becoming vulnerable and allowing God to work in or through us. Maybe it's practical things. Maybe you just need to read your Bible and blow off the dust on that. Open it up every now and again. Maybe you need to share your faith with somebody. Invite them to an event. Let them know we're not all weirdos, us Christians. Maybe it's serving at church. Maybe you've been greeted, welcomed, served. Your kids have been cared for. Maybe God is calling you to actually serve. Maybe it's becoming more generous. Maybe it's going on a missions trip, just like the 11 that we just sent out a few days ago or in Thailand, ask you all to keep them in your prayers. Maybe it's spiritual. Maybe for you it's not spiritual, it's practical. Maybe you need to exercise more. Maybe that's what God's been putting on your heart. You've been putting off, kicking that can down the road. Maybe it's getting organized, you know, in your home, in your calendar, in your finances. Maybe it's going back to school. Maybe you've been saying to yourself, that's not practical. I got so much going on in my life, or education so expensive, and yet God's been calling you to start a college program, go back to school, take a class. Maybe it's becoming honest about a life-controlling issue in your life that you've been pushing down, that you've been suppressing. Maybe for you it's not spiritual or personal. Maybe it's relational. Maybe you just want to carve out the time to spend more time with your kids. Maybe, like I said earlier, you need to start dating your spouse again. Maybe it's to reconnect with someone you haven't spoken to in a while or seen in a while, find out how they're doing. Or maybe it's to mend a broken relationship. What is the good that you ought to do that you know is right? Not easy, but right. And thus far, you've been putting it off. I think we need to get specific if we are to adopt a two-day mentality. Once we have identified it, then I think the next thing we need to do is this. We need to end the excuses. We need to end the excuses. See, coming up with excuses is really, really easy. You know, first couple days of December, I started to feel a little under the weather, a little listless, and I exercise every day. Part of my exercise is just stretching, because did I mention I'm 50? I stretch, I exercise just about every day, but the first few days in December, I just feel a little run down, a little listless. You know what I said to myself? I said, self, I'm going to put it off for just a couple days. December's a packed month. We got a lot going on in the church, a lot going on with holidays and family and travel. I don't want to get run down. I don't want to get sick, so I'm just going to put it off. Well, wouldn't you know it, that entire month went by. I didn't exercise once. I didn't run once. There was no cardio. I felt horrible. Put on some pounds. My joints were all achy and stuff. I just fooled myself into thinking this was just to ward off an illness. This was just going to be for a couple days. When the fact about the matter is there wasn't a bone in my body wanted to go and run and exercise. We do that. We come up with excuses. Other people have excuses. We have good reasons. I didn't want to get sick. Right? But I think that the truth is that if we look for an excuse will be easy to find. Ben Franklin said it this way: he that is good at making excuses is seldom good for anything else. If we allow ourselves to find excuses, to justify our procrastination with excuses, boy, one or multiple will be easy to find. It's easier to make excuses. It's easier to blame shift. It's easier to not take personal responsibility. We either make excuses generally in one of two ways. We either make excuses by pointing out what needs to happen before we can act. You know, all the people that got to do their part, all the things that have to happen for me to do this thing I've been pushing off, and I'm just waiting for them. It's really their issue. Right? Or we tend to write the scripts. We tend to say, if I do this thing, boy, then he's going to say this or she's going to feel that. And, you know, we tend to say this bad thing will happen if I act, so therefore I won't act. Proverbs 22:13 says it this way. The slacker says, I love that word, the slacker says, there's a lion outside. I'll be killed in the public square. There's no lion. It's this scenario building. It's this script writing and filling in our own blanks to say, I'm going to be able to stay in this comfort zone, really, in this cocoon that I've built. Sometimes it's in our mind. Sometimes it's our literal, you know, fortresses that we build. And I like to call it our Christian gene pool. You know, we just stay in our homes and with each other. And this whole part of the Bible about going and making disciples and baptizing and teaching them to obey all that I've commanded you, that's for somebody else. You know, sometimes we make excuses that just cut off and negate big parts of the Bible, big promises that God has, big charges and commissions that God wants us as Christians to do, because I don't do that. That's for somebody else. And we make excuses in order to stay in the comfort zones that we've built up for ourselves. Who hears excuses? Teachers tend to hear excuses, right? Those of us who are teachers here, my dog ate my homework. Yep, use that. I love when I was in school and I knew that a buddy of mine didn't have his homework. And then the teacher would say, okay, everyone pull out your homework and pass it up to the front. And my buddy would just start looking around, pretending like he had it and didn't know, looking at papers and in folders. I don't know. I don't know what happened to it. You know, banking on the good graces of the teacher. Okay, just hand it in tomorrow. And then he got 24 more hours to do it. We tend to give excuses to teachers. We tend to give excuses to police officers if we've ever been pulled over. Do you know why I pulled you over? We tend to give excuses to that group as well. You know who else hears excuses? Jesus. Jesus hears excuses. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 14, 15b through 20, it says this: blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God. Jesus replied, a certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. This is a good thing. This is a party. This is a banquet that's being prepared. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, come, for everything is now ready. Today, it's a party, and it's for you. This is a good thing. You know what happened? But they all, like, began to make excuses. The first said, I have just bought a field, and I must go and see it. Please excuse me. I thought you went to the field first before you bought it. No, this guy bought the field. Now he's got to be excused because he's got to go see it. Another said, I just bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm on my way to try them out. You know, didn't pull up to the oxen dealership and test drive the oxen, just bought the oxen. Now's got to go and check them out, see what they're like. Please excuse me. Still another said, I just got married, so I can't come. None of the men in this room have ever used that excuse, right? Excuses are all throughout the Bible. Adam blamed Eve. Eve blamed the serpent. Moses blamed a speech impediment. Jeremiah blamed youth. Gideon blamed weakness. When it comes down to the things that we know we should do, but we are thus far not doing them, it far too often boils down to this. Too often, we convince ourselves that our unwillingness is really an inability. Too often, we convince ourselves that our unwillingness is really an inability. We say things like, I can't communicate well with my wife, instead of, I won't communicate well with my wife. I won't take the time. I won't actively listen to her. I won't get to know how she's wired, what her personality is, what her demeanor is, so that I can meet her right where she is as I communicate. We say things like, I can't, because it's just too hard. It's too difficult for us, instead of, I won't. Or we say things like, I can't share my faith with others, instead of, I won't, because it takes me out of my comfort zone. It makes me feel uncomfortable. But you start to listen to people, and I'm a communications guy, so I tend to have antennas for this, who use the phrase, that doesn't make me feel comfortable. If that phrase starts coming up a lot, that's an indicator, right? And this idea of can't and won't, if we shift our can'ts to won'ts, it puts the ball back in our court. It puts the camera on us. It shines a light towards an opportunity for personal responsibility. When we say we're unable, we usually mean that we're unwilling. See, maturity and faith results when we do the right thing regardless of how we feel. When we do the right thing because it's the right thing. Managing our emotions is so important. Instead of following them, I don't feel comfortable with that. You know, God didn't feel comfortable when sin entered the world. Jesus didn't feel comfortable when he hung from a cross. You read the Bible, there's a lot of amazing things that happened in and through discomfort. Managing our emotions is so important, or we become slaves to them. So we need to get specific about what it is that we need to be doing that we've been putting off doing, and we need to identify and can the excuses. The third thing we need to do is we just need to begin. We need to begin the process. We need to take that first step. Perhaps you're not doing the thing that you ought to be doing, and because you have a someday mentality, you're waiting for the opportune time. You're waiting for someone else to make the first move. You're waiting for things to improve in your situation before you can do the right thing that thus far you've been putting off. I think this is a pretty appropriate verse for this neck of the woods. In Ecclesiastes 11:4, it says this, farmers who wait for perfect weather never plant. If they watch every cloud, they never harvest. If we wait for the ideal scenario, if we wait for everybody and everything to be perfect and ideal before we do the thing that we know we should be doing, we're never going to plant, we're never going to harvest, we're never going to eat. Sometimes the best thing we can do is just start. Just begin the process. Even when we don't have all the answers. The psalmist says in 119, your word is a lamp for my feet and a light on my path. That kind of denotes that we're not going to see the whole thing. We're going to see the next few steps. And sometimes the best thing we can do, even when we don't have all the answers, is to begin. To begin the process. In Zechariah 4, verse 10, it says, do not despise these small beginnings, for the Lord rejoices to see the work begin. Sometimes if we decide we're going to forego this someday mentality, I don't have all the answers, the situation's not ideal, the conditions aren't perfect, but I'm just going to begin. I want you and all, everyone here to be encouraged with the idea that God rejoices in that. God desires that. God wants us to just begin. To start the process. I've heard it said that the hardest piece of equipment sometimes to use in a gym as the front door. Sometimes we just gotta start. We just gotta open it up. You know, like I said, my exercise I do down in the basement. Sometimes that's the hardest handle to turn. It's just the door leading to the steps downstairs. Perhaps you're not doing the good that you ought to be doing because you simply don't know how. That sounds on the face of it like it's really the only legitimate excuse. I mentioned before about ending excuses. If you say, I just don't know how to do this, that sounds legitimate. But this idea of beginning the process, I would put the question back to you, have you asked for help? Have you actually begun the process by asking for help? If you're in a job and the job's not going well and you're not performing as you should or you're not perceived as you should, have you asked for help? Have you asked for additional training? Have you asked for a clarification of expectations? If you're in a marriage that's not going well, have you asked for help? Have you rung someone's phone? I mean, I've been a pastor for a while. I've heard people say, we're heading towards divorce. I'd say to them, I mean, I'm not the end-all be-all, but my phone hasn't rung. Have you asked for help? Have you begun the process, if you say, I don't know how to do this, to ask for help? See, we live in a world today in the 21st century where information is so readily available. It's so convenient to access. It's so customized to almost what it is you're thinking. I don't know how Siri and Google seem to know what you're thinking, but they do. I mean, in a millennial generation, we've got a whole generation of people that they don't get stopped if they don't know how to fix something in the engine. They YouTube it, right? They don't get stopped if they don't know how to put the flooring down. They YouTube it. Now, the flooring might look really like they YouTubed it, but at least they begin. And we need to do that as well. We need to begin the process. James 1:5 says it this way, if any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault. Who gives generously to all without finding fault. What is he going to say? What is she going to do? A lot of times we get ourselves stuck in that someday mentality because we fill in our own blanks. God is filling in the blank for you. He's going to give it to all. He's going to give it generously, and he's going to give it without finding fault. If you ask, it will be given to you. If you don't have you asked? Have you begun the process to ask? So I think we need to just start. We need to take a step of faith even when it's not easy. It's not easy to ask God. It's not easy to ask others. It's not easy to give generously. It's not easy to invite someone into your life or to your church. It's not easy to make that phone call when you haven't been in touch with somebody or when a relationship needs mending and you hit that last digit of the phone number or you craft the email and you hit that send. That's not an easy proposition. God wants us to just start. He rejoices in those small beginnings. So we need to identify what it is. We need to can the excuses. We need to just begin. And the last thing I want us to think about is to embrace uneasy. It's not easy to do these things. And I think we need to embrace that truth. I think we need to embrace that reality. In order to avoid feeling uneasy, we often decide to stay right where we are. It makes us uneasy to begin something when we don't have all the answers. And God wants us to begin. It makes us uneasy to come clean about something we've been struggling with. And God wants us to begin. It makes us uneasy to make that phone call and to say I'm sorry and to ask for forgiveness. And God wants us to begin. How will it be received? What will they think? What will they say? Will they stick around? I have found in my life, and I think this is replete throughout the Bible, that most things, most good things in life contain some level of discomfort. That's why I say for all of us to check ourselves, and if somebody in our life uses that phrase, that just doesn't make me feel comfortable. That's an indicator That's an opportunity to shine a light right there. Most good things we can accomplish. Most good things we can learn. Most good things we can grow to. Spaces we can step into require and contain some level of discomfort. There's a level of awkwardness, no doubt, to say, I'm sorry. To say it was my fault. Putting a period at the end of that sentence. That's uneasy. That's why James, in the final chapter of James, talks about healing. Confess one to another so that you may be healed. Admitting fault lifts heaviness, lifts burden. Kicking the can down the road actually makes it more difficult to do the good thing that God wants us to do. You know, when I became a pastor, I asked many people who were pastoring about the job, about the calling. You know, what's it like to be a pastor? What are the good things? What are the challenging things? What are the difficult things? And they gave me a whole mess of wisdom. But uniform, consistent throughout their answer was this. One of the hardest things about being a pastor is you want something more for someone than they want it for themselves. When you can see the area in this topic of procrastination that God calling us to do, it's the right thing, it's the good thing, it's the thing that, like I just said, it'll lift burdens. It will allow you to live up to the fullness of the plan and the purpose, the giftings that he's put inside of you. And you can see it, but you're stuck. You're stuck with a someday mentality. You're stuck kicking that can down the road. It makes us uneasy to opt for help, particularly, for example, in marriage, when our society, our world makes divorce so easy, so convenient to get. And a lot of times we say, I don't want to open up. Then I've been pushing it down and everyone's got a perception of me. If I open up, if I become vulnerable, then everyone will know the issues I have. Newsflash, we know you have issues. You know how we know? Because we have them too. We already know. This big idea I want to come back to is that many of us believe the lie that it'll be easier to deal with things someday. The truth is that doing the right thing only becomes more difficult if we put off doing it. We got to get specific about it. We got to seize that day. Not the arrogant boastings of the future. That's not really promised to us. Remember, we are a mist here for a short time. Receive, redeem, honor God with that gift that's really all around us, the birds in the air, the fruit on the trees, the flowers. He wants us to appreciate, to receive, and to honor him back with the gift of today, to can the excuses, right? To just begin, start, despite the uneasiness, to take it to the bank that it's going to be uneasy, and to embrace it if we want real growth to happen. I'm going to ask, would you stand with me? How do I stop procrastinating? This is a topic, like I said, we tend to put a lot of humor and a lot of language around that kind of insulates us and almost rationalizes our putting things off, the good things that we know we should be doing. When maturity and growth in Christ and our relationship with Christ happens when we just decide we're going to do the right thing regardless of how we feel. We're not going to follow our emotions because our emotions can deceive us. The heart is deceitfully wicked among all who can trust it. We follow our feelings as a rule of thumb. We're going to end up becoming slaves to them. I want to pray right now that our time today would encourage us, regardless of whatever that thing is that we've been putting off, that we would get serious about it, that we would honor God with the gift of today. Let's come to the Lord in prayer. I just pray right now, Lord, and ask you to forgive us for kicking that can down the road, for putting off the good things that we know we should be doing. For us, it's sin. Lord, we want to thank you. We want to reframe our perspective. We want to renew our hearts towards the gift of today. And I pray that you would use the scriptures that have illuminated how you feel about this topic, Lord, as a reminder for us to not only get specific about what it is that we need to begin doing today, but that we would look to you instead of making excuses, that we would be encouraged that you delight in small beginnings and the progress that we make despite the uneasiness, and that we would look at that uneasiness, that discomfort, as a part of progress and a part of growth and a part of accomplishing every good thing, so that we can sound more and act more and look more like your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Let us continue to worship the Lord now.